We're all leaders, whether you know it or not. Every one of us are leaders. We may not all be effective leaders, but we're all leaders. And it starts when you're young, when you're influencing your friends. Probably your biggest responsibility as a leader is with your children. But every one of us is a leader. Our greatest power to have lasting influence on the people around us is rooted in our everyday behavior, not what words we use to tell others. You know, you have to walk the walk. You've all heard that. You've also heard, do as I say, not as I do. Boy, that's not servant leadership. That is not servant leadership. So let's spend a minute thinking. And you've all got paper. We're not going to spend a lot of time on this, but you've all got paper. So name the 5 richest people in the world. Name the last 5 Heisman Trophy winners. Write their names. I know you know them all. Name the last 5 Miss Americas. Come on, you all have to know this, right? Name 10 Nobel or Pulitzer Prize winners. Come on, start writing fast. I'm not seeing very many pens in motion. Name the last 6 Academy Award winners for Best Actress. Name a teacher or two who aided your journey through school. Name 3 friends who have helped you through a difficult time. Name 5 people who have taught you something worthwhile. Think of a few people who have made you feel appreciated and special. And think of 5 people you enjoy spending time with. So what's my point? Leadership is a process of influence. Anytime you seek to influence the thinking, behavior, a development of a person toward accomplishing a goal, you are taking on the role of a leader. It is the act of taking an individual or group to a place that they would not normally go on their own. So those first few questions, I mean, even if you were able to name a Heisman Trophy winner, or if you were able to name a Miss America, did they have any effect on your life? No. Because leadership is about relationships. Leadership is not about money or power. It's about something that comes from within. And it starts with integrity, and it works toward relationships. So effective leadership starts on the inside. Are you a self-serving leader, or are you a servant leader? A self-serving leader does not accept feedback, believes that feedback means you don't want their leadership any longer. And there was something short I wanted to read. This is the Catholic Vision for Leading Like Jesus. And it says, Ken Blanchard calls feedback the breakfast of champions. It's easy for us to agree with him when the feedback is positive. Everyone loves positive feedback, but many of us struggle with critical feedback. Effective servant leaders, I'm using the word servant leaders, seek out feedback, and when it's critical, they try to learn from it. They don't take it all at face value, just as all positive feedback isn't equally useful or even accurate. So it is with negative feedback. But without accurate negative feedback, how would we ever improve? Finding and using critical feedback to improve ourselves and our ministry is what separates mediocre performers from champions. If we hope to do better in the future, we need to keep getting feedback that permits us to learn and tells us where we can improve. So A self-serving leader does not want that feedback, cannot deal with that possible critical thought. A servant leader takes feedback positively, looks at it as a source of useful information on how they can provide better service. A self-serving leader wants to protect his position. His biggest fear is to lose it. He's addicted to power and recognition. And this is when I always like to add that if a ministry has the same leaders for years and years and years to come, they're denying someone else the opportunity for leadership and the opportunity for perhaps some new ideas. I think one of the worst things in the world that as a ministry leader you could say is, we've always done it this way. That's kind of like the death knell of improving anything. I mean, even if your ushers have been in place, there's been ushers forever, there's always some new thoughts. So consider, you know, grooming someone to take your place. Whenever I'm meeting with, because we are, in the South, we're opening new churches. Whenever I meet with a priest that's beginning to start a new church, I said, consider term limits. Call it something else, but 3 years. Consider 3 years. And the second year, the leader of the ministry should be grooming the next leader so that there's never a sovereignty. There's always fresh ideas, and there's always new leaders being developed. A servant leader, position is a non-issue. A servant leader looks at the position as a loan and an act of service. A self-serving leader does not take effort in training a replacement because nobody could do it as good as I do. A servant leader takes every effort to plan a succession. A self-serving leader is a baby. A servant leader is an adult. So here's Pope Francis again. It's hard to imagine, well, maybe except for, of course, St. Teresa of Calcutta, it's hard for me to picture anyone quite as servant leadership minded as Pope Francis. He says, so the church is Christ's, she is his bride, and all the bishops in communion with the successor of Peter have the task and the duty of guarding her and serving her, not as masters, but as servants. The Pope in this context is not the supreme Lord, but the supreme servant, the servant of the servants of God. He said, true power is to serve, to do service, to do the most humble services. And I must still make progress on this path of service because I feel that I don't do everything I should do. That's the sense I have of power. True power is serving, not being served. It's important that we build relationships within our ministry. We can't be so busy in the task of doing that we ignore being. So it's very important that we're always working on relationship building within our ministries. So why now? It's the Francis effect. He's bringing a whole new perspective. And this new perspective will bring positive change within our parishes. We need to be refocused and go back to our basics. Love God, neighbor, see Christ in each other. We must be more dynamic than ever because too many people are leaving our parishes. I want to make a side note on this. Just recently, I read about the life of Elizabeth Le Sueur. Has anyone ever heard of Elizabeth Le Sueur? I'm kind of jumping back to a topic we talked about a few minutes ago. All of us have someone that we love that's not going to church. All of us do. Elizabeth Le Sueur, it was her husband, and she spent her life praying for her husband, who was an acclaimed atheist and an authored atheist. I mean, he wrote papers bashing faith and bashing the Lord. She spent her whole life praying for him, but she loved him. After she died, he converted, became a priest, and was very authored. So don't give up. Please don't give up. We may not see it in this lifetime, but we might see the results in the next. We face many new challenges as a church. My gosh, sometimes I feel like Christianity is just being, well, we know it's being persecuted in other parts of the country, but sometimes even here, you know, I sometimes feel like Christians are being persecuted. And we need more of you to step up and assume more active leadership roles. Jesus was the ultimate servant leader, and he had 10 practices or principles in applying servant leadership. We're just going to spend, at your table, we're going to spend like a minute on each one of these. When I describe a practice, try to recall an event from Scripture that illustrates an example of how Jesus used this practice. So I'm going to describe a practice. You're going to discuss for 1 minute how Jesus put it into action. So when I say, what was Jesus' first miracle, you all would respond, the miracle at Cana. Jesus valued diversity. So how did Jesus show in Scripture, where does it show that Jesus valued diversity? His 12 apostles. What a ragtag group that was. If any group was diverse, it was his 12 apostles, that's for sure. Okay, we were discussing the questions a few minutes ago, and if you have never seen or heard this, the book is called Living Your Strengths, the Catholic Edition. And I wholeheartedly suggest that you purchase it. Inside the book, there's a tab that you open it up and it has a code. And it tells you to go online, use that code, and it's giving you a test. Has anyone taken StrengthsFinders? Anybody else? Oh, good. We've got some StrengthsFinders here. Okay. So there's a test. It was put together by Gallup, and it's been tweaked for Catholics. You want to take this test when you have 25 minutes undisturbed. You do not want to be interrupted while you're taking this test. And it's many, many, many questions. You have to answer them quickly. They're timed. And at the end, you will get just within a few minutes, you will get a list of your 5 strengths. Actually, your 5 talents. They're God-given. They're something that they're given to you for you to develop. Because we do not have the same talents. They're all on a spectrum. Some are relationship building, some are developing ideas, some are carrying out ideas. But in a ministry, it's so important to have a mixture of talents so you can have a diverse group. A few years ago, a pastor said to me, I've got this great stewardship council. They come up with the best ideas, but nothing has happened. And I said, this group needs to take strength finders. Oh, that was me. This group needs to take strength finders because you probably have an entire committee of ideation. And they're coming up with wonderful ideas. But you also have to have those people in your group that can take those ideas and put them into action. And then you have to have someone in the group who can inform the others what this group is doing. So we need to have diverse ministries. We can't all be of the same gift or talent. We've got three parishes in Atlanta where every staff member has taken the test. They have gotten a coach to help them understand their particular talents. And then now it's going out into the ministries where the ministry leaders have all taken the test, and then it's growing out into the parish. So there's some dynamic things that a parish can do with strength finders. So now I'm going to go back. Whoops. Okay. Jesus valued diversity. That's where I was going with all this circular, in the circuitous, is that we need to be diverse. He sought other points of view, and he accepted new and contrary opinions. And the example from Scripture is, look at those 12 apostles. He surrounded himself with fishermen, tax collectors, carpenters, soldiers, tradesmen. Jesus created a culture of trust. This is so important in ministry. He delegated responsibility and believed that everyone would fulfill their goals. So what would be an example from the Bible of how Jesus developed this culture of trust? Jesus entrusted the apostles with the overwhelming responsibility. He entrusted 12 men, because by then Judas had split, Matthias had come in. He trusted 12 men with spreading Christianity throughout the entire world. That's, to me, that's amazing. When it comes to establishing a culture of trust, it's very, very important that your friends, that your people in ministry can trust you. They can trust you not to talk to others about a problem you might be having with them. Because if you're having a problem with Paula and you go to Liz as a sounding board, Liz is going, eventually it's going to get back to Paula, but Liz is going to know that you can't be trusted when she's got a problem with you. So when you have a problem with someone in ministry, be someone that is capable of being trusted and go to the person you're having a problem with. There's a story I read. A fella in ministry that was preparing for an event similar to this, and Saul was asked to set up the chairs and have them set up by 11 o'clock. Deb was the one that was in charge of the whole thing, but Deb had had one hell of a bad day. Everything from the dog making a mess in the kitchen to her husband dropping the bag of garbage out in the yard, everything that could go wrong in Deb's life that morning had happened. And so then she got to the parish hall. Saul was really, really busy, but he hadn't put those chairs up. And Saul said, Deb, I'm sorry, I forgot to put up the chairs. And Deb says, naturally. Saul doesn't realize that word had nothing to do with him. It had nothing to do with him. It had to do with the fact that she'd had the morning from hell, and here was just one more thing. So it would be very important for Saul to say, maybe not right that minute, because Deb's probably got smoke suit, but later to say, Deb, I'm sorry that you were upset with me, but I kind of took it to my heart when you said naturally. And that's her chance of saying, oh God, that's not what I meant. That is not what I meant. And there, that relationship is healed immediately. Immediately. The healing is done. From my own personal experience many years ago, 25 years ago, I made a smart-ass remark to a friend of mine, but we weren't like this yet. We weren't like that. We were like getting there, but we weren't. And I, you know, it was cutting and it was not kind. And as soon as she left, it hit me like a brick that I had really hurt her. So I got in the car and I went to her house and I begged forgiveness. And she and I are like that now. We are so good friends. And it's because instead of her bitching to somebody else about what a bitch I was, or me complaining to someone else, I took it to her, I apologized profusely, and a relationship was not only just saved, but it flourished because she knew she could trust me. Trust in your ministries is so important. Jesus developed leaders. He nurtured his apostles. He let his apostles fail. And how about examples from the Bible? Peter denied him 3 times. God, that must have hurt. Jesus developed leaders. He nurtured his apostles. He taught them. He was very specific in certain times. Do this, don't do this. I mean, there were times, and I can't tell you the scripture right now, where he was very, very specific on what they were going to do and what they needed to bring with them, et cetera, et cetera. So there were times when he developed them very specifically. And then there were other times where he encouraged them. Instead of going over the same thing, he encouraged them in their ministry. He molded Peter to become the rock after Peter denied him 3 times. So we need to be very encouraging in our ministries. And one of the best things you can do is to, if you're a ministry leader, is send thank you notes. You know, maybe not every time there's a function, but at least make sure that every member of your ministry is getting a thank you note at least once a year, thanking them for their service to the ministry and to the parish, because we all need encouragement. Jesus instinctively helped people. He had compassion and love for everyone. The woman being stoned, all the miracles. He provided encouragement and support. The apostles had to go outside their comfort zone. I mean, they, if I recall right, they couldn't even bring an extra cloak with them or an extra stick. Asked Peter to walk on water. Man, could any of us have done that? And he sent the Holy Spirit after the resurrection to provide the apostles with strength and courage. The loaves and fishes, that's another example of supporting those who were following him. He taught by example. He showed everyone how to live a holy life. And remember from the other talk, people will forget what you said. They'll forget what you did. They'll never forget how you made them feel. They will remember you, knowing whether or not you were a person of prayer, a person who loved the Lord. We can never get so involved in our ministry that we neglect our relationship with God. Prayer has to be a daily portion of our time. We have to have time, we have to set aside time to pray. And I don't mean the, oh God, you know, I have this to do or whatever to do. I mean time really spent in prayer. He persuaded rather than commanded. I mean, think again of those 12 apostles. So we have examples of how he showed everyone how to live a holy life. He retreated. Jesus went on retreats a lot. And, you know, if you read scripture, it says he went off to prayer. We don't know how long. It could have been an hour. It could have been a day. It could have been 5 days. But Jesus retreated to prayer. And I hope all of you are taking a retreat, at least once a year, take a retreat. I don't know what you have in this area. In Atlanta, we are blessed with a monastery Mother Angelica's, what does she call it? Basilica? Shrine in Hayesville, Alabama. And we have Ignatius House, which is a retreat. But we need to refuel. Jesus needed it. If he needed it, we certainly need it. We need refueling. So what are some examples? The use of the parables, the sower of the seed, the Good Samaritan, workers in the vineyard. He made complex concepts easier to grasp. Sometimes those parables are a little difficult. Sometimes they are. But I think our faith life evolves and things get easier as we evolve. He focused on others first. I mean, Jesus was the ultimate servant leader. He always put you ahead of me, meaning him. He came to serve, not to be served. This go back to, you know, the Francis Effect and Mother Teresa. Those two people just stand out in my mind as being the ultimate servant leaders next to Jesus himself. So what are some examples from the Bible of Jesus as the servant leader? But his passion and death, his resurrection. Jesus anticipated the future. Yeah, he knew what was going to happen. He had a vision of what had to be done. I mean, I think he probably knew for years what was going to happen. What was an example from the Bible? All the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, he had his visions of what had to be done. The enduring role of the Holy Spirit was always with them. And he told them that when he appeared after the resurrection, isn't it, that he said that the Spirit would be coming to them. Jesus was humble. He had no titles or signs of power. He instinctively assumed the role of servant. This should be easy. What is an example of Jesus' humility? The birth of Jesus in a stable, Inquisition by Pontius Pilate, Satan on the mountain. Jesus chose to do his Father's will rather than satisfy his own human wants and desires. And that's where that shows up a lot, is the Satan on the mountain. Jesus was very mission focused. He maintained his perspective. He stayed on task. Example from the Bible, the crucifixion and his purpose for being. After the resurrection, his 12 best guys had locked themselves in a room because they were so afraid. They kind of lost their perspective at that point. Jesus was the most successful leader of all time. And we can emulate his actions by following the practices. Value diversity, cultivate trust, develop leaders, help people, encourage them, teach by example, focus on others, anticipate the future, humility, and staying mission focused. And this is what I go back to. I hope your ministries have a mission statement. And if they don't, let that be one of the first things you do the next time you meet as a group, is to develop your mission statement. And it needs to be short. so that it is easily remembered. It needs to be posted where your ministry leaders will always see it. It needs to be reviewed once a year. Are we following our mission purpose? Because if you are not, you need to redirect what your ministry is doing. So please, if your ministry does not have a mission statement, develop it, review it, and make sure that everyone knows what it is. Okay, so at your tables, I want each of you to share a short story. We don't want you to control the whole table. A short story about the best servant leader that you have encountered, whether it's your home, church, social, or office. So do that right now at your table. Okay, I'm going to bring you back. Bring your attention back, please. I hope all of you had an opportunity to share. In my 24 years at the Archdiocese, I have had some magnificent, magnificent leaders, and I've had some others that should have been in chains. So I'm sure we all have someone that we can really remember as a fine servant leader. So what is the difference between management and leadership? Managing is the process of planning, organizing, implementing, controlling. Leadership is the quality. Leadership comes from within. It's an integrity. It's the quality to motivate, inspire others. We're not alone in our ministry. We need to let others be involved. Managers have people work for them. Leaders have people follow them. There's a big difference. Your next step, I suggest three books: The Servant Leader, Lead Like Jesus, and The Catholic Vision for Leading Like Jesus. If your actions inspires others to dream more, learn more, do more, and become more, you are a leader. And I thank you very, very much for your time and your attention. Thank you.
Oh, my.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, I'm humbled. Thank you very much.